Hello everyone, and welcome to How to Write Powerful Creative Briefs. We're gonna give you some useful tips today to do great work with clients, great work with your teams, and to set your projects up for success. We're gonna go ahead and jump right in here into the material, and I'll start by just introducing myself for those who don't know me or haven't been to any of my trainings or sessions before. My name is Kevin Namaki. I am a former brand leader. I spent about 20 years working in brand management, working on mostly consumer brand teams, about 15 years of that on the client side, working among those teams and leading those teams, and then about 5 years of that working on the agency and consulting side. So I've been on both sides of the fence. I'm going to try to bring some of that perspective to you here today. A little bit more about my background. I've held a variety of roles, from beginner roles up to more senior roles with a lot of different direct reports, so just a lot of different situations and scenarios. And then I also have degrees not only in marketing, but also in education, and I've got an MBA, which has helped me run some of those consumer businesses, as well as run a department at an agency. So I started this business, the Gurulocity Brand Management Institute, because I knew brand leaders needed help training their teams, agencies needed help training their teams. It's something I saw in my personal experience, and so we've built our entire business around that. So we're here today to help you. I also do trainings for the American Marketing Association, so you may run into me there, and occasionally go back and lecture at the Indiana University Kelly School of Business. All right, so here's your typical logo screen. Agency people, you'll recognize this because we do this all the time. But the main point here to get across is that what you're gonna see today is a best practices approach, and it works across a variety of categories and a variety of industries. So you'll be able to apply it in a lot of different situations. So when you get into creative reviews, whether you're a client or an agency partner, it often can feel like this. It can feel pretty daunting, like there's a big wall, a big mountain you've got to climb. A lot of times there can be a disconnect between the client side and the agency side of what's expected or what constitutes good work. Sometimes people don't know what to say. Sometimes the brief is good. Sometimes the brief is bad. Sometimes there's no brief. And so there's a lot to overcome here. So I know that it can feel like this when you sit in a meeting, but we're going to help you today overcome some of this with a few of the things that I'd like to teach you and share with you. Our big overall learning objective is to empower you to lead great creative work and work better with your clients. So knowing that most of the people attending this conference, it's an agency audience, that's our objective for the day. And in general, you'll just get some insight that's going to help you advance your career and do better in your career. What we're going to learn today more specifically, we're going to talk a little bit about what great creative briefs do. We've got to kind of define the purpose of the brief in order to know how to write one really well. We're going to talk about the ideal creative development process, what's flawed about typical processes, and how we can improve the process. Although this is not necessarily specific to just a brief writing, it's very important that we talk about this because the brief fits into this larger context, and how we use the brief in that process matters. We're going to talk about the actual template, the ideal creative brief framework, and we're going to show examples of that. And then we're going to learn how to isolate the communication strategy, which to me is the heart of the brief. It's the most important and critical part to get right. So we're going to show some examples of that as well. At the end of today's training, I suggest you visit the website I show here, gurulocity.com/summit2022. There's some special things there just for this audience. You'll be able to get an ultimate guide on how to actually write every part of a great creative brief, as well as get more information on trainings that help you think like a marketer, as well as our new brand management training programs. All of that's at that special link just for this audience. So let's jump right into it. What all great creative briefs do. Typically, when we're starting out and we begin a creative project, or a client comes to us with a creative project, it's going to start in one of a few ways. So, and this is why a creative brief is important. Most of these communication campaigns are going to start with either the client saying, hey, let's get a brief over to the agency so we can start work on this project. Or sometimes a client won't do that and the agency will have to speak up and say, can you send us a brief so that we can get started on the work that you've asked for? Another way it might come, maybe from the client side, they might just ask you to write it. Can you write a brief for us to review? Regardless of how that happens, it all starts with a brief. In any of those scenarios, everything's gonna start with a brief. And so there's three really important things every creative brief must do. One is the creative brief needs to outline strategy. It has to lay out specific direction for the execution, specific strategic direction. All right, our communications must actually do something specific for the business. There are business objectives here, and it needs to meet those specific objectives. So it's gonna, a good brief is gonna lay out what those things are. And last but not least here, good strategy about making choices. A brief forces the team to make choices. And if you don't make choices along the way, you're gonna end up with a very poor brief and a really cumbersome and frustrating process. The second thing is inspiration. And a lot of times this is what agencies and creative teams really push for. They want the inspiration, and clients don't always know how to necessarily deliver that. But I mean something specific. So a good brief sets an inspirational starting point. That's a little bit different than maybe what some commonly do. Commonly in creative briefs, there's a lot of vague inspirational language. And I think from a client's perspective and having been on both sides of the fence, that's a little bit dangerous, because when vague language is in your brief, that can cause problems later on. It leaves it too open to interpretation. And then last but not least here, number three, an agreement. A creative brief is an agreement. A good brief will define success and also tell us what a good creative product looks like or what a good creative product must do. It's gonna set expectations for what's going to meet approval at the end of the process. All right, the brief is the closest thing we have to some sort of objective measuring stick. So it's not just I like, I don't like at the end of the process, it's does it meet the brief and how well does it deliver what we've outlined in the brief. So when you put it all together, my definition, my recommended definition of a creative brief is it's a document that clarifies strategy, sets an inspirational starting point, and it outlines what we agree on, the requirements that a piece of work needs to have when we evaluate it at the end of the process. Put in a much more succinct way, it's a strategic, inspirational agreement. So that's what I would try to remember. So now we're gonna hop into the process. The typical creative development process has a lot of flaws in it, and this is put together from what I've seen across many companies, many agencies. This is typically how the flow goes, and I think it's flawed. Usually it starts with the client writing a brief, and usually some kind of manager, maybe a brand manager, marketing manager, writes that brief. They may or may not get approval on that up their chain of command, and they'll send that over to the agency. Now, then an agency will usually review that, and in many agencies, it might be an account manager or a planner that's gonna take that in, do it some sort of initial look, maybe bring in some other team members, and they're gonna decide what's important in that brief and what's most useful in that brief, or maybe what's missing. And then often what happens is the agency is gonna write a new brief, what they would call the creative brief, and it's in many cases just used internally. It may not be shared back with the client. So you'll have a client or project brief now, and then a second agency or creative brief. So right away, there's an issue here because you have two competing briefs. Now, some agencies view these two things as being very separate, and we can't, you know, have those two worlds merge because that would be problematic. I'll show you in a minute here. I think those two things should come together. We should have one sheet of music that the client and the agency agrees to, which is gonna make our process better. But oftentimes it's rewritten into a new brief. That new creative brief gets shared with creatives and the creative work begins. But a client may not have aligned to it. They may not have seen it in some cases. If they've seen it, it's different than their original brief. So now we have some competing ideas. So it can be problematic. Then those ideas, the creatives are gonna draft those ideas. And then typically what will happen these days is agencies or creative teams will come back and share the work in some sort of detailed format, like a storyboard or scripts. This is also problematic because a lot of clients will get hung up on details that don't matter at this stage. When you're developing new campaigns and big ideas, you wanna focus on the merit of the big idea. What's the big picture here? What's the vision? What's the big idea that we're really driving for? And how might that come to life? When we get into things like storyboards and scripts, it can just be a distraction. They will comment on things that don't matter or that aren't critical to the idea at this stage. So this is also another place where I believe the process is very flawed. Clients will then see these boards. They'll give new feedback. They'll give things that maybe weren't originally in the brief now that are gonna come up later that you didn't know about. The client maybe doesn't love the work. Maybe they can't articulate why. Maybe they're referring to something they put in their original brief, but that wasn't in the team's creative brief when that brief got rewritten. And so there can be a lot of swirl here. You can get new information from the client they didn't share before. You can get new stakeholders involved that have different feedback. It can all be kind of a mess. Ultimately, it leads to unhappy clients, unhappy agency team members, and really nobody being that happy with what's happening. And in the end, time crunch comes in, time crunch sets in, the deadlines come around, and you have people on both teams, both sides, settling for work that they don't feel as good about, and honestly just becomes mediocre work. There's a lot of mediocre work that gets produced by teams because of this flawed process. So we want to avoid the flaws, and let's talk about what's more ideal. In an ideal creative development process, you're going to start with homework. Now, this really you're really relying on the client to do this. They need to be doing this homework. But in cases where clients might be relying on you to do it, then be aware that someone has to get it done. That homework is going to be marketing plans, insights, looking at prior research, figuring out what the communication objectives are, which is probably one of the most important things at this stage. And they're going to collect and collaborate on those things up front. Really, what we need to do in the homework phase is explore what are the opportunities and with whom are those opportunities. And we may have multiple options for the answers to those questions. So that needs to be discussed among the client team and possibly between client team and agency if we're all involved in strategy. The next thing that needs to happen is draft up these top communication strategies. I would recommend drafting these up before you even write a brief. And I'm going to show you today what these communication strategies look like. So come up with those options, have a discussion around which ones are the strongest, and align on one communication strategy and objective that's going to be the foundation of your brief. Once you get to this point, now someone can draft a brief. If it's the client, fine. If it's the agency, fine. But I strongly believe you should draft one brief and align on one format and one framework that both the client and the creative teams can all get behind. So you're singing from one sheet of music. And I'll show you that recommended format here in just a moment. At this point, before work begins, I also believe it's important to get senior level approval. And my general rule of thumb is approval should go to the same level up in the chain of command on the client side, that same level that in the end, when the work comes back, the creative work is going to have to be reviewed and approved. So if a CMO or a president of a company is going to see and approve the creative work at the end of the process, then they need to see and approve and align to the creative brief. Otherwise, you will have a huge disconnect later in the process. Now you can have your kickoff meeting, and I would suggest doing this between creative and client teams all together with the one brief. Have everyone get on the same page, answer everyone's questions, then do your creative ideas, come back and deliver those ideas. I believe those ideas should be delivered, like I said, in a less detailed format, more of a big idea format, and that's the best way to focus on the merits of a big idea without getting hung up on details that don't matter early in the process. Once you've aligned then to a few of the top ideas between client and agency, then you can add the detail and do storyboards or scripts. If you follow this, you're gonna have an easier time getting to the revisions and the good feedback and the approvals that you need later in the process. It's gonna save you time later. So let's talk about what is in the brief. We've talked about the overall process, but the heart of this, the foundation of it at the beginning, is a creative brief, a good, strong creative brief. So the ideal creative brief, I believe, fits on a page, one page brief, and it has what the creative teams, what the agency needs to set about and have the direction to do the work they need to do. And it has also some of the strategic elements, some of that communication strategy that the client also feels is really important. Now, there are going to be other things in the brief as well. And you can see here, I've suggested this template that you see at the bottom. It says page 2+. So there are a lot of things that clients love to put into project briefs or creative briefs or whatever you want to call them that simply aren't critical or mission critical to understanding the heart of the creative strategy. And so those are going to be things like business background, success metrics, competitive analysis, detailed segmentation information about the consumer, mandatories, long lists of specifications and requirements. Like maybe you need to know all that information and that needs to be in there, but call it an appendix or call it page 2+ and pull exactly what the creative teams need out of that brief and have it on page 1. So this is how I suggest client teams and agency teams come together to align on one brief framework and format that has what both parties feel is important. Now, What goes on that first page? What's the one-page creative brief? You need to know the assignment at a high level. You need to know the target, whom we're speaking to, the key tension, problem, or insight. So why does this matter at all? You have a current behavior, and along with that, a current belief. So what's the sort of the current state of the customer or consumer, the audience that we're speaking to? What are they doing and what are they feeling or believing? And then you have to flip that into the future state. What's our desired behavior? That is the communication objective. And what is the desired belief? That's the single-minded proposition or the key takeaway that the campaign is going to need to communicate. Supporting information, you'll have reasons to believe or supporting details that then support that idea, that desired belief, and then character and tone. So how are we going to speak when we speak to this audience? That's the recommended format I suggest. It's the most important thing things for a creative brief, all on the first page. And then the client can, and you can still talk about, and we can still deliver additional information, but put it on the subsequent pages. So you don't want creative teams having to dig through the brief to find these things within a longer brief. Just let's bring them all right up front. So let's look at some examples. Example creative briefs. Now these are inferred and placed into my recommended format, but I'll show you examples of how great briefs might be written and then the ads in the marketplace that these briefs are based on. There's two of them. The first is Mountain Dew. So our Mountain Dew creative brief is as follows. The assignment is, let's create a new campaign across mediums, so a variety of tactics that leverage our NBA partnerships. So they were trying to promote using their NBA endorsers. Their target audience, teenage NBA fans who associate themselves with the brands that they consume. They take on a brand's personality as a reflection of themselves. The insight here is that teens are always told to conform, to be what others expect them to be. This is in direct conflict with what they really want to do. They desire to stand out as individuals, be unique among their peers, and enjoy being their rebellious selves. So there's this conflict, and that's the core insight that we want to base our campaign on. That's our opportunity. So currently, these teens might be drinking and doing what everyone else does or what's expected of them. They're kind of going with the flow, so to speak. So the current feeling and belief that's associated with that is, it doesn't matter what I drink. You know, it's not like a big deal. It's not top of mind for them. They don't really see it as a meaningful thing. So what do we want in the future as a result of this campaign? The desired behavior is to go from the drinking and doing what everyone else does or what's expected of them to actually getting excited about what they drink and switching to Mountain Dew. And in order to do that, they would need to think, feel, or believe that drinking Mountain Dew is cool. It helps me stand out as myself. The reasons to believe will be all of the stars, right? So that's going to be the rebellious standout stars that they admire that are in the NBA. So that's what we're going to leverage. And we're the character and tone, we're going to be unapologetic. We're Mountain Dew. We're a daring rebel. We're not afraid to be provocative. We're the friend that's fun to be around, but just crazy enough to do the things you only dream about. So this is a pretty tight brief. It's one page, and it sums up our communication objective, what our opportunity is with the consumer, what's going on today, what we want to move them to in the future in terms of desired behavior and belief. And here now you can see the spot that is based on this creative brief.
They say don't practice shots you wouldn't shoot in a game. They say don't pregame to slow jams. They say don't eat seafood in Oklahoma. They say don't be a team distraction. They say a lot of things. Don't do they, do you.
So there's Russell Westbrook for you. A very entertaining spot, but it gets the point across that was in that brief. Don't do they, do you. Kind of be who you want to be. All right, so let's look at one more creative brief. This is for Adobe Stock. And the assignment was to come up with a new online media campaign. And the core question or impetus for this is, how do we show off what you can really do with Adobe Stock? How are we going to do that? And Adobe Stock is online stock photography, which on the agency side you might be familiar with. A lot of us have design and creative teams that use stock photography or video in some of our projects. And so the target audience is graphic designers, freelancers, creative departments, agencies. But there's an insight here that they view themselves as artists. They're creators. they're creative people. They hate limitations. We don't want limitations on our work. So the insight here, though, is that while we use stock photography in so many projects, most stock photos aren't really any good. They're cheesy. They don't look good. And it makes it hard to, it's hard to find good pictures, and it makes it hard for your project to really come together in a way that's inspiring. Sometimes this stuff just looks cheesy and uninspiring. Put really simply, stock photos limit your art as a creator. So that's the core insight or tension that we want to solve for and base our campaign on. So the current behavior is designers are using poor, in this case the competitor is iStock, poor iStock photography, and they're just dealing with the frustration. They're kind of unaware that there's better stuff out there. And if that's the current behavior, then their current thought, feeling, or belief is probably something along the lines of, I hate stock photos. They keep my work from looking good. So we want to change that. Once we communicate with our audience, we want the desired behavior to be for them to switch to using Adobe stock for their next project. And what is the thought, feeling, or belief that's required to get that behavior? Well, we need them to believe or feel that Adobe stock offers limitless potential. It's the starting point for our next work of art. Reasons to believe. Visually show them all the amazing photos we have, but also some of the unique search features and licensing functions that make it easy to work with Adobe stock. And then the character and tone. Clever, inspirational, limitless creator who's serious about their craft. And it's reflective but energetic, a little bit of a magical touch. So let's take a look at the work that's based on this creative brief.
In 1990, a pair of thieves entered the Gardner Museum and cut the Storm of the Sea of Galilee from its frame. It hasn't been seen since. My name is Ankur Patel, and I'm tasked with taking Rembrandt's missing painting and recreating it entirely from Adobe stock. I'm gonna start this painting like Rembrandt would have with the sky. The cool things about Creative Cloud is that you can search for Adobe stock in Photoshop. You can warp it, liquefy it, add effects, change the color, and you can directly license it. The watermarks go away and everything stays intact. I use 3 or 4 stock images per face. If I like somebody's eye and somebody else's lips, I merge them together. One of the portraits in the painting is a self-portrait of Rembrandt. I wanted to add my own self-portrait. The whole process of finding the stock images inside the Creative Cloud saves a lot of time. With Adobe stock, my creativity is uninterrupted and I can make a masterpiece.
It's a great piece of work. With Adobe stock, I can make a masterpiece. And they actually did a number of paintings, commissioned a number of these painting recreations for lost or stolen works of art and recreated them and made a whole campaign around it. So a really great piece of work. All right, so we've looked at a couple of examples of good creative briefs in an ideal format and even seen some of the work that would have been based on those briefs. So the next thing that we need to talk about besides process and creative briefs is the communication strategy itself, which is the heart of a great creative brief. So while today with the limited time we have, we can't walk through the lesson on how to write every single piece, part, and sentence in a brief, what I want to focus on is the most important part, the communication strategy. And this is made up of 4 key elements in the center of a creative brief. And what I like to do when writing these or teaching how to write these is to use the 4-box framework, which is a pretty traditional framework, but I don't think it gets used very often these days. But it's extremely useful for thinking things through and making sure you have linear connections in your strategy and that everything works together. So you take these four components of the brief and you write them together on a page. And this is what I would recommend doing and trying to flesh out as the first step before you write a full brief. Understand what your potential directions are for your communication strategy and discuss those as a team and align on those. So in the top left here, you have the current behavior. This is what people do today. So what does the consumer or customer do today that we want to change? Once you have that in place, you're going to think about, well, what is our desired behavior tomorrow? What do we want the consumer or customer to do as a result of our communication? So there's kind of two sides of the same coin. Now we have to associate beliefs, thoughts, and feelings with these things so that we know what to communicate. We need to assign it that current belief. What does the consumer or customer think or feel today that results in the current behavior? And then similarly, the other side of that coin is the desired belief. What must the consumer or customer now think or feel in order to elicit our desired behavior? And if you do this properly, they're going to line up. So the top row left to right, they're going to be two sides of a coin. Same with the bottom row left to right. You also want to look vertically and make sure that things are in sync. Does that current belief that you see, is that really associated with that desired behavior or what's maybe driving that behavior? All right, so make sure those things are in sync and in line. So next, let's just look at a couple of examples. This first example here is for H&R Block. This is a campaign that H&R Block ran a few years back, and it was based on a core insight or an educational insight that most Americans were leaving money on the table when it came to their taxes because they were doing their taxes themselves, making mistakes, and there's a bunch of refund money just sitting there that no one is claiming. So they leveraged this insight for a campaign. The current behavior, they were targeting consumers who filed their own taxes. That's what they were doing. They weren't using tax filing services. They were just doing it on their own. And so they wanted to change this behavior to using H&R Block's walk-in services. Use H&R Block's expert team members, expert accountants to do your taxes and get it right. So how do we get consumers to switch? Well, we think first about why are they filing their own taxes? What is the belief or feeling that they have that leads them to do that? Well, they might think that filing their own taxes is simple and easy. It's simple enough to do, so why wouldn't I just do it myself? It's going to save time and money, easy enough. But really, they're unaware of all the deductions they're missing and the mistakes they're making. So we need to change that. If we want them to switch then to using the walk-in services, then the desired belief would be something like, oh, I'm actually missing out, and H&R Block can help me get that money back. So that's how you use the four boxes and write the communication strategy. It's the most important and critical part of the brief. So using this strategy now, let's watch the advertising that came as a result of this strategy.
Shh. Do you hear that? It's your money. It's refund season, and nobody gets more of your money back than Block. Guaranteed. Get your billions back, America!
So there you go. Get your billions back, America. All right, so the next one we'll look at one more example, but we're going to flip it around. I'm going to show you the ad first. And as you watch this ad, I want you to think about, what is the behavior before and after seeing this spot on the part of the consumer? So what's the consumer doing now? Maybe how does the brand want to change that behavior? And then what's the belief before and after? What is the belief of someone that maybe this is targeted at? And what's the belief the brand then wants to move them towards to get the action that they want? What do you think the communication strategy is for this spot? So this is actually for Barbie.
And I'll be your professor today. And I will be talking about the brain. Hello, I'm your veterinarian today.
You're kidding.
Nope, I'm Dr. Brooklyn. See?
Okay, doctor.
Oh, here, let me see. Good morning, everyone. I'm your new coach. My name is Maddie. Nice to meet you. I had the most fantastic day in the office. You'll never believe what happened. We got that new business I wanted. Have you ever seen him fly?
Have you seen what?
Fly?
No.
My cat can fly.
Okay.
The dog's brain can't think as much as the human's brain because there's no high school for the dog. This is Peter, the Triceratops. Peter is 1 year old. The T-Rex, Sally, is 1,002,252 years old. Knees up like a unicorn. Higher, higher. I've been to New York, Transylvania, Pennsylvania. We can think and do lots of stuff with our brain. Now, does anybody know how big the brain is? Anybody? Sophia. It is medium. Medium. Very good.
A clever and cute campaign from Barbie. So let's take a look at what the communication strategy is behind this spot. In order to do that, you first have to think of who are they speaking to. And they're actually trying to speak to mothers. They're not necessarily creating this ad for children or for the girls who play with Barbie. It's really for the moms. And so here's the current behavior. They don't want their daughter playing with Barbie. Maybe they don't let their daughter play with Barbie. It's not part of their conversation, and it's not in the mix or collection of toys that they allow their daughter to play with. And so what's the desired behavior that they want to change? Well, they want moms who don't let their daughter play with Barbie, they want them to reconsider letting their daughter play with Barbie. So how would we get them to reconsider? Well, what's the current belief? If a mom's not letting their daughter play with Barbie, then it's probably based on a belief like Barbie is sexist. They're a bad example for my daughter. Maybe they're an old relic, and she limits my daughter's aspirations. She has this idea of what Barbie is, possibly from when she grew up herself. And so that's a negative perception of Barbie that's maybe driving the current behavior. So if we want to move her to the new behavior, reconsider allowing her daughter to play with Barbie, then there needs to be a new thought, feeling, or belief that we generate. And in this case, it's Barbie helps girls imagine all the great things that they can become. So that's the mental shift that we want to create with the campaign, and that's exactly what that spot does. All right, so we've reached the end of our time here. We had, a limited time today, but we went through a lot, and it's time to wrap up. Here are the main things we learned today. We learned what all great creative briefs do. They're strategic, inspirational agreements. We learned the ideal creative development process and where we can fix some of the flaws in the way that a lot of creative is created today. Then we also saw some ideal creative briefs, ideal format and framework, and some examples of work and actually having that framework filled out for notable pieces of work. And then last but not least, how do we isolate that communication strategy and really make that top notch so that it sets the brief up for success as well as all of the work that follows. So hopefully we've met our learning objectives here and you feel like you're at least one step closer to being able to lead great creative work and working better with your clients. And you'll be able to use some of these tips and frameworks and pieces along the way to help create better work, but also boost your career. The next time you get in these creative meetings, hopefully it will feel a little bit less like some sort of daunting challenge and like something you're prepared for, an adventure where you've got new tools and frameworks in your backpack that you can use to make the process better, make the work better, have the creative teams be happy, and the client teams be happy. One final step, I mentioned at the beginning, there is a special site created just for attendees of the agency summit. And so you can go to gurulocity.com/2022, and there you will find the ultimate guide to writing creative briefs, step-by-step how to write each and every component. You'll find a way to get information on some of our trainings on how to think like a client. So this is training specifically for agencies. There's also some information there for if we have any brand leaders in this audience. We do have a brand management accelerator program that you can get more information on at that site. And last but not least, you'll find links for things like our social accounts. If you want to get more email tips or even just have other general questions, you can contact us there as well. So thank you for your time. Thanks to everyone putting on this great event for having me, and let's connect soon.